In this course, we're talking primarily about anatomy specifically related to speech, but anatomy is organized in the same way as the rest of anatomy is, from smaller structures to larger structures that are more complicated. So we're going to talk a little bit about those different building blocks for anatomy, from smallest to largest, the cells, the tissues, the organs, and finally the systems. Cells are the basic building blocks for almost all types of anatomy for humans and animals. Cells are highly organized masses of protoplasm. How cells work depends on their shape and structure. Every cell has a nucleus in it that's crucial for the cell reproducing itself and making cells of similar types. There can be other types of cellular material inside the cells depending on their function. Here, for example, we have a variety of other cell materials. Some might be found in all cells, like mitochondria that provide energy to the cell. Others might be found only in specialized cells, like ions and neurotransmitters that help with intercellular communication in nerve cells. This level of detail is not going to be terribly important for this class for any particular cell that is relevant to us. We'll go into the detail when we cover that particular piece of anatomy. There are also intercellular materials in the body that can be relevant to how structures function. So for example, basically what makes up bones is not cells so much, but the intercellular material between those cells, mostly calcium. There are bone cells that do have a function, but what we think of as bones are actually mostly non-cellular material. Tissues are very important to us, basically because these are the smallest gross anatomical structure that has some sort of useful form and function to it. So we're going to go into a fair amount of detail on different types of tissues, epithelial tissues, connective tissues, muscular tissues, and nervous tissues. Epithelial and connective tissues are primarily structural tissues. Muscular tissue is what forms muscles and makes movements happen. And nervous tissue is what forms the nervous system and transmits commands throughout the body. So epithelial tissue is a bunch of cells that are stitched together with not much intercellular substance that make up various definable surfaces, either on the outside of the body, inside various tubes and passages in the body, or inside even completely internal cavities in the body that do not connect to the outside of the body. All epithelial tissue has a free surface and rests on a plate of collagen, which is a type of connective tissue. Epithelial tissue may be ciliated, a special term. You'll notice in anatomy we have a lot of special terms for things. Ciliated epithelium is epithelium that has tiny hair-like structures on it. So that could be, you know, the outside of your body skin that has hair on it, or in the lungs, for example, there are cilia that help move foreign materials up out of your lungs toward your mouth, basically, so that you can clear the lungs and cough them out. The epithelial tissue proper, sometimes called the epithelium or the epidermis, is the skin on the outside of the body, as well as the continuation of that skin into internal membranes that are continuous with it, like in your digestive system or in your respiratory system. So this would line the inside of the nose, the inside of the mouth, down into the lungs, down into the stomach, all of which are going to be relevant for us in this class. Epithelial tissue comes in a lot of different types. It can be relatively flat, which is referred to as squamous, or it can be relatively thick, referred to as columnar. And then the tissue can have either a single layer and be considered simple, or several layers and be considered compound or stratified. So depending on how flat and simple the cells are, it may be a very thin layer, like in the inside of the lungs where respiration happens. Or if it's very thick and multi-layered, like on your skin itself, it can provide a barrier to the outside world. Connective tissues are tissues that connect or bind other structures together, help support the body, or aid in bodily maintenance. We have loose connective tissue that's pretty similar to epithelium, and also not terribly important to us. We're going to have a variety of dense connective tissues that are going to be very important to us, as well as a variety of bones that are going to be important to us. Blood is technically a connective tissue, but we're not too interested in the study of speech. That loose connective tissue, sometimes also known as areolar tissue, is a layer found just beneath the skin, that collagen membrane I mentioned before. Particular type of areolar tissue called adipose tissue is the tissue in your body that stores fat cells used for energy. We have a variety of types of dense connective tissue that are going to be important to us. One type is fascia, which is a skin-like wrap around muscles, organs, and various body cavities. We also have tendons and ligaments that connect pieces of the body to each other. Tendons connect muscles to bones and cartilages. Ligaments connect bones and cartilages to each other. Last but not least, cartilage itself is a dense connective tissue. Cartilage provides cushioning to bones and is also stiff enough to provide some body structure. There are different types of cartilage, from more elastic cartilage like that that you find in your pinna, which is the external part of the ear that you can see in your nose, or in the epiglottis, which is a structure in the back of the throat at the base of the tongue that's going to be important for swallowing. We have somewhat less elastic cartilage called hyaline cartilage that generally lines the joints where different bones come together. There's also some important hyaline cartilage that helps make up the respiratory tract that we're going to talk about. And then last but not least, there's very fibrous cartilage, the least flexible, most stiff. Contains a dense network of collagen fibers as well as cartilage cells that's found in some joints, like in between the discs in your spine, for example. Bone or osseous tissue is composed of cells, collagen fibers, as well as a lot of inorganic salts. Primarily, bone consists of intercellular substance. These intercellular substances are organized in layers in a way that's referred to as a lamellar structure. So we have layers of these collagen fibers and intercellular substance that are organized rather than just random. That's why, for example, when bones break, you can get little shards out of it because the bone is organized in a particular direction. Bones are covered by a fibrous membrane called the periosteum. Whenever I think of this, I think about like a hand weight that has a neoprene wrap around it. It's sort of like the weight part is the bone and the neoprene wrap is kind of like the periosteum. Periosteum provides an attachment point for our tendons and also helps in repairing bones when they're damaged. When bones or cartilages come together, we have a joint. Joints are classified based on the degree of movement they allow and what kinds of movement that can happen. The book goes into quite a bit more detail on different types of joints. For here, I'll just cover it at a broad level. All those different types of joints won't be a big focus for this class, though you may run into a question in a quiz or in the exam. But generally speaking, we have very mobile joints that are referred to as synovial joints. These would be most of the joints that you would think of in the body, like at your knees, your elbows, and your fingers and whatnot. We have cartilaginous joints with less mobility, so maybe between the vertebrae or connections from the ribs to other parts of the body where they can move a little bit, but not a lot. And then we have fibrous joints, which you wouldn't think of as joints at all. Like in the adult skull, the bones are basically fused together. That connection is a fibrous joint. Muscle tissue is another important aspect of structure for us. Muscle tissue is responsible for all body movements. What we generally think of as muscle tissue is striated muscle, long muscle fibers that are arranged in bundles that are under voluntary control. So things that let us move our arms and legs around, or in case of speech, let us move our jaw or our lips or our tongue, or things inside our larynx that we'll talk about. There are two other types of muscle: smooth muscle that's involved in involuntary movements and things like digestion, and cardiac muscle that is what makes your heart beat. Muscle fibers come together to form muscles in units that are both functionally and anatomically defined. Anatomically defined meaning you can see the structure. So for example, the fascia surrounding the muscles gives us an anatomical definition of what a muscle is. Tendons attaching muscles to skeletal structures. A tendon will attach a muscle to a skeletal structure and create a particular functional movement. Muscles also have a nerve supply that stimulates when they contract. They have a vascular supply that gives them nutrition to make that contraction happen, which is on the basis of the movement of chemicals and ions to create a signal. The way muscles work basically is to shorten. Any particular muscle can exert a force in just one direction and in a straight line. When people describe muscles because of this pretty simple way in which an individual muscle works, they describe it in terms of an origin, the less mobile part of the muscle, and an insertion, the more movable part of the muscle, giving you some idea of sort of the connection of the muscle and its function. Most movements that you can think of, bending and extending your elbow, have movement in more than one direction, which basically means that more than one muscle is going to have to be involved there. So in our case, for speech, for example, opening the jaw is going to involve muscles contracting in one direction. Closing the jaw is going to involve different muscles contracting in the opposite direction. So then when we start talking about these more complicated combinations of actions, we can talk about the relationships between the actions of different muscles. So for some particular movement, like closing your jaw, we would have one or more prime movers or agonists, the muscles that make that action happen. To be able to undo that action, there would be antagonists, muscles that act in the opposite direction. So if your prime movement is closing the jaw, your antagonist movement would be opening the jaw. And then in some cases, we have structures that aren't quite as firmly rooted as something like the jaw is. So there may be other muscles that need to act synergistically to stabilize things to make a particular muscular action happen. And I know some of this terminology is kind of vague at this point, but the idea is for most movements in the body, there are muscles that make that movement happen. There are muscles that make the opposite movement happen. And then there may be related muscles that are involved in some way, but that aren't directly involved in the movement or the opposite movement. Muscles are named in a variety of ways based on their shape, like trapezius shaped like a trapezoid, or serratus shaped like a serrated blade. They can be named based on location, so things like intercostal or internal or external names attached to muscles give you some idea of where they are. We have biceps and triceps, which are named after their number of heads. We have muscles named after attachments like the sternothyroid, or named after functions like the tensor tympani. Nervous tissue is highly specialized cells for communication. They are elongated and respond to environmental changes by changing both electrically and chemically. They transmit signals along axons and relieve signals to their dendrites. And that's basically the communication system throughout the body. Here's an example of nerve cells over muscle fibers. So the big pink blobs are muscle fibers, and the little gray lines over them are the axons connecting to the muscles that would send a signal to contract. Organs aren't a terribly important unit for us in this class. They're kind of well-defined informally, but there aren't too many movements at the level of the organ that's important for us. We're much more interested in systems, bigger compositions of things coming together, and in particular in speech, we are going to look at a variety of systems throughout the body. We'll be going through systems in this order.